all have a need of something. There's none of us, don't matter whether we are rich, poor, middle class, wherever we are in life, we don't have everything all together. All of us standing in need of something. Myself as pastor of this church here in St. John, I stand in need of something. I stand in need for God to give me wisdom, to give me guidance, to give me clarity as how to pastor and orchestrate the church he assigned me to. I stand in need. Many of us are standing in need of something, whether it be for help, whether it be for our children, all of us are in need. There are some in need for tuition to go to school, some in need for a job, some of us are in need for a car, and many of us are in need how to take care of our aging parents. There's a need there. There's a need that we are looking for. There's a need that we have right now. Many of us need cash, finances, right this moment, to be able to make ends meet. We can't make ends meet the way we need to make them meet. So we are standing in need. And I want you to know today God has brought this word to you that if you are that person that's standing in need, God has a word for you. And he wants you to know that there is help for those who are standing in need. And all of us are here today listening for a word that will be coming from the Lord. And it's the same thing in this text with this Syrophoenician woman. This Phoenician woman had a need. And she had a need that was so strong that she would take any length, do anything to take care of her children. And she heard that Jesus had gone into this house. And I want you to know this now. When Jesus went in, his presence couldn't keep silence because of who he was. And I want you to know that if you are out there today, and you are a child of God, and this Holy Spirit lives within you, you can't keep it hid. Somebody will see it. I don't care how you look or how you act. If you are a child of God, that Holy Spirit is within you, and the light's going to shine, and the world going to see it. So, Jesus couldn't hide. And this woman had a need that she was willing to take chances to get. In other words, she knew that she had to do something for her daughter, because her daughter was possessed by the devil. And when your need becomes so desperate, you would do anything to meet that need. And many of us, sometimes we become too proud, too sophisticated, to admit that we have a need. And that's why many times we won't get our need answered, because we don't admit we have a need. And God already knows we have a need. And God stands and waits for you to ask, to come to him. Because the word says, you have not because you ask not. I'm standing here waiting to help you with your need. All you got to do is just come to me. Come to me and ask, and I will supply your needs. If your burden get heavy, come to me. I lighten your load. If If your burden get heavy, I may wait for you. You need to know how to come to God when things are going on. Because I want you to know, in life that we live in, there's sometimes there's an itch that we can't scratch. We just can't get to. There's something wrong with our problems, something wrong that we can't reach. And many times there are problems and situations only Jesus can handle. And we have to learn to humble ourselves and go to him in prayer, and he will open up doors for us and make ways out of no ways for us. But we have to learn to trust him. Now this woman, she came to Jesus, and she couldn't come to Jesus any kind of way. It was hard for her to come to Jesus. Because remember, this woman, Matthew's called her a Canaanite. And then Mark calls her a Greek Syrophoenician woman. In other words, she was a pagan woman. In other words, she was a woman that even the Jews looked down on her and called her a devil. In other words, she was a nobody. She came from Canaan, where they had many gods, idolatry. And so this woman was a nobody, but this woman had to come to see Jesus. And she was willing to do anything and everything that she had to do. I got to get to Jesus somehow. And so she was willing to be called whatever she was called, because she had a purpose in mind. She came from this region of adultery. She was a woman that was one paid against her, this being a woman. Women just couldn't go around certain places and do certain things. And then on top of that, she was a pagan woman. But she had a reason to come to see the Lord. She had a reason to come to God. So she made her effort and pushed her way in to see God. And really, with her characteristics, she really had no business in the presence of any Jews, and especially in the presence of Jesus. And one thing about it, she was following Jesus and his disciples. And she would follow him. And whenever they would stop, Jesus would stop. She would stop. And she would be in the background. And I can imagine she would be saying, Jesus, Jesus, the Son of David, have mercy on me. And I want you to say, I know many of us today go to God in prayer. Go to God and pray for our children. Because as many times our children are at the bus stop, I can't be with them. They're going to school. I can't be with them. They're going about their daily duties, and I can't be with them, but the devil is trying to attack them. I'm praying, Lord, have mercy on my child. Lord, have mercy on me. I know myself, as a pastor, as a husband, as a father, I'm constantly praying for the Lord, have mercy on my wife, Emma. I'm constantly praying, Lord, have mercy on Tara, Latoya, Wendy, Dana, my children, and my grandchildren. I'm constantly calling on his name. Not only my family, but I'm calling on this church family. This church that God has assigned me to. St. John Missionary Baptist Church, I want you to know your pastor is constantly praying for you at night. He's up at night thinking about your welfare, thinking about your well-being, praying that God would keep the devil at bay. Constantly praying. I can relate to this lady. I can understand where this lady is coming from. Because she knows that the devil has a hold on her child. But she's praying. And she comes to Jesus. And she says, Jesus, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on my daughter. And I can imagine Peter and the disciples getting upset. This lady is making too much noise. She's a pagan. She's a nobody. We can't do nothing for her. And I can imagine they were about ready to get on this woman's case. And Jesus, you know, many times when she was calling Jesus was silent. He wasn't saying anything. And I want you to know, just because you called Jesus and he's not saying anything, it doesn't mean he's not going to bless you. When he's not saying anything, it's a time to test your patience. You just stand still. Because you know what Isaiah said. Say, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up like eagles. So in other words, you got to learn that when he's not saying nothing, does not mean he's not going to bless you. Because he still has the power. And Jesus finally spoke up. He finally spoke up and said, the children must be fed. In other words, Jesus came to save the household of Israel. He didn't come to save this pagan woman. He came to save the household of faith. He came for Israel. And this lady here was not in line with the makeup and the reason for his coming. So Jesus said, now, I got to feed the children of faith first. Now, I don't know about you. Jesus didn't turn the woman down. He just told her that I need to feed the household of faith first. And the woman said, I can imagine, she said, yes, Lord, I understand that. I understand you got to feed the children of Israel first. I understand that. Because even crumbs will fall from the table down to the dogs. And she understood how, Lord, I don't mind being settled. I don't mind waiting on you. Because I know your settling is just as good as your first. See, when you know who you are and whose you are, and know God will make things all right. And I don't know about you. A lot of things that second day is better than the first day. I don't know if you ever had some pinto beans, ham hocks, cooked in that gravy, stewed up just right. The first day they're pretty good. But you let them season over to the next day, and you get down into the next day, even better the next day. And so with the Lord, you know, even though you tell me to wait, and if I can't get it right when I want it, you may call him, and he may not come when you call him, but one thing we know, he's always on time. So this lady, she had it in her mind that she wasn't going nowhere. She was going to wait because her daughter was possessed by the devil. And I need Jesus to run this devil out. And so she was waiting there, patiently, waiting on the Lord. And the Lord did not turn her down. And Jesus said, with the answer that you gave me, she said, he told her that the devil is already gone from her daughter's body. And so the lady understood, because she kept praying. And she kept praying for Jesus and kept calling his name. And I want you to know, when you call Jesus' name, don't stop calling his name. Don't say, well, the Lord heard me, I'm going to stop. No, you keep on praying. You keep on praying, because one thing about this woman who was a Canaanite, and she was a pagan woman, but she still was a mother, a woman with a need, just like all of us. And so Jesus, if he listened to her, Because she came. Because she had heard some stuff. And she put what she had heard with what she believed. Because when you know God for yourself, and you know what he has done for you, then you can go out and tell the world that God is what he said he is. He told Moses to tell them that I am that I am. So she had heard about Jesus. She had heard the things that he could do. She had heard he was a God. She had heard he was a miracle worker. So when she came to Jesus, I can imagine she was saying, Lord, I heard that you went to a wedding feast. I heard that they ran out of wine. I heard that your mother came to you and said, Jesus, the wine is gone. You say, woman, what is that to me? I heard you said, look around and you saw six water pots. You said, fill the pots to the brim. Somewhere along in that water changed the wine. I heard the governor of the feast came by and said, it ain't the best wine for that. I heard that you were in a preaching ceremony. You were in a teaching class. Out on a great big field. And it got late in the evening. And people began to get hungry. I heard there were 5,000 men out there. Plus women and children. All the grocery stores were closed up. No stores were nearby. All you said was check in the vicinity, see what we got. I heard you better two little fish, five barley loaves. I heard you picked it up in the word glory, and you blessed it in glory, and you said feed the multitude. You fed 5,000 men, plus women, plus children. Am I right about it? But I didn't only hear that. I heard there was another time when there were 4,000 plus men, plus women, and children. And you fed them. I heard there was a man that had a withered hand. You told him, stretch your hand out in that hand. Carry to the water. When the angel come down to drunk the water, Jesus said, I ask you, do you want to be made whole? The man said, yes. Jesus healed him right on the spot. I heard the man roll up his bed, put it on his shoulder, and we're walking on down the road. I heard that you came walking upon the sea of Galilee, walking on top of the water. I heard there was a storm one day. You were on the ship, down at the bottom, sleeping on the bottom, but the ship was tossing and turning. I heard the disciples came down and woke you up, said, Master, care if we perish. Jesus got up, wiped sleep out of his eyes, stepped out on board the ship, spoke to the wind. The wind went on back home to glory, spoke to the lightning. The lightning stopped flashing, spoke to the water. The water calmed down, calm enough to rock a newborn baby to sleep. Disciples began to look at one another. Peter looked at John. John looked at Nathaniel. Nathaniel looked at Bartholomew. Bartholomew looked at Judas. Judas looked at James. What manner of man today, the reason you are watching today and listening to this word is because all of us are in need of something. All of us need God's name. I know you are here today because you heard he was born in Bethlehem. I know you are here today because he was raised in Nazareth. You are here today because you heard he was baptized in the Jordan. You are here today because you heard of the miracles he performed. You are here today because you know he's Mary's little baby. You are here today because you heard he's a bright and the morning star. You are here today because you heard what he had done for others. You are here today wanting to do the same for you. Wanting to open up doors. Am I right about it? You are here today because you heard he's Adam's Redeemer. You are here today because you heard he's David's heart. You are here today because you heard he's Samson's strength. You are here today because you heard he's Joshua's battle axe. You are here today because you heard, you heard, you heard. You are here today because you are looking to God. You are here today because there's something you need. You are here today knowing that God can bless you. You are here today because the faith that God has given you. All of us have been given a measure of faith. You can step out on your faith. You can step out on your faith and believe God will do the undone. Step out on your faith. Step out on your faith. Don't catch any ships. Believe in God. Trust in God. Watch what he'll do. A lot of times God will hold out to the end. But if you hold on to your faith, God loves you so much and he wants you to be taken care of. He has so much invested in you. That's why he sent his son, Jesus Christ. He didn't want all of us to die and go to hell. God has so much invested in us that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, that we may be not go to hell. In other words, he sent Jesus. And when I think about the goodness of the Lord, and I know I feel his presence, when I think about what God has done for me, I want you to know the Lord is my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and they fell. Because I know God will provide a hiding place. And if you be like me, you can look toward the hills for which cometh your help. The Lord who made the heavens and the earth. And I don't care what's happening in the world today. God got us. All you got to do is stand in faith. Because we, all of us, are standing in need of something. I don't care how rich, how poor you are, or middle class. You may look like you don't ever need nothing. He is alive. You are in need of something. Because God orchestrated it like that. And there's a void in us that only can be filled by God. Material things can't fill it. Nothing can fill it but God. He wants us to know that. And I hope this word reaches healthy heart. And we hope it gives you some encouragement that if you don't come when you call him, that's not a sign he's not going to bless you.
Jesus.
Now the sign he's not going to answer your prayers. That's a sign for you to stand on your patience. But you didn't engage your patience. And wait on the Lord. Because you see, God can see everything. We can't see but so much. He knows what's best for us. He knows when we need it, how much we need it. And that's why we have to put our trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord with all thy strength. And lean not to your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him. The things are going wrong. Say, Lord, I don't understand it, but I'm going to thank you anyway. Because you are in control. And I know you're not going to allow no more to come to my table than I can bear. Help me to bear this cross that's coming my way. Help me to get through what I need to get through. And he will, if you trust him. We all have a need. Now let me open these doors of this church, because there may be someone here today that have not given their life to Christ. God knows they have a need. If you are listening to me today and you've been contemplating, you've tried everything you can, and it seems like it's you go up one hill and you're down another. Somehow or another, you can't seem to get it right. You fix one thing and lose two. What you need is the Lord. Let me tell you something about the Lord. When you go through these things, don't think the person that knows the Lord don't go through stuff. But they go through stuff. When you know God, you go through it. Knowing you're already a winner, already, but God wants to bless whatever your shortcomings and your fall, he's still going to guide you right on through. For those who know God, don't worry about the trouble that comes their way. That God may serve, blesses them to get through. If you are one of those today that's been contemplating giving your life to Christ, and maybe you haven't done it yet, and this is your opportune time. And I'm happy to direct you to God. And if you want to give your life to Christ, it is so easy and so simple to do. I want you to repeat with me. Because if you die and haven't given your life to Christ, in hell, you wake up. In hell is not a place where you can go in and spend 30 days or 45 days, 90 days, and get out. That's eternity. So this is a very important decision we want to make right now. If you're ready to give your life to Christ, I want you to raise your hands up in the air toward heaven. And say, Father, I am a sinner. And I believe that Jesus died for my sins. And Father, I believe that you raised him from the dead. And I believe he's sitting on your right hand. And just by me testifying and believing that, my belief turns into salvation. I'm saved. Because I believe Jesus died for my sin. I'm saved. You are saved. You're saved right now. You believe that in your heart, you're saved. And I ask right now that you find you a church home, a Christian-based church home. Study the Word of God. Learn more about Him. Study the Word. And at some point, you will be to join that Christian-based church. And now that you are saved. And I want to thank God for sparing you this time to give your life to him. In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen. Now let us go to God in a moment of prayer. Sweet hour of prayer. Jesus said, man ought to always pray in season and out of season, and to meditate day and night. Lord Jesus, it's me again, and I'm coming, God, on behalf of all of the blessings you have bestowed upon us. And I come, Father, this morning as a spokesperson for the church that you assigned me to pastor. I come asking, Lord, that you look upon the St. John's members, those that are under my care. I pray, God, that you would put your arms around them, wherever they may be in life. I pray, God, you bless their children, bless their grandchildren, and I pray, God, you keep them safe from this coronavirus. And I pray, God, that as they go to and from school, I pray you bless the teachers, principals, other school members. God, keep us safe through this pandemic time. And I pray, God, you bless the parents with wisdom and knowledge how to handle and how to be parents. And Father, I want to thank you again for this election. And Father, we know and understand that as we've made our votes known, we pray that however the election was to turn out, we were going to trust you. We were going to trust you, Father, even if you have allowed President Trump to remain, we still were going to trust you. We were going to be just like Job, even though if you slay us, I trust you was going to be in. But Father, right now, I pray for Donald Trump. I pray you would bless him with the blessing that he stands in need of. Bless his children anyway. Bless his cabinet. And God, bless his administration. And I pray that you bless Joseph Biden, Kamala Harris, as they take on leadership. We're going to thank you, Lord. We're going to praise your name because your name is great. And Lord, we love you and we care about you. And Father, I pray that you, the thing that I did not ask, maybe I did not know what to ask for, those who are in need of a job, those who are in need of health care, I pray for that. That you would open up your avenues for them to be taken care of. I pray, God, for these churches to soon be open again one day. I pray we find an antidote for this virus. And God, we can open back up and but in the meantime, keep us faithful. That we can do what you need us to do. Lord, if there's anything I missed in asking for, please do not miss in giving. In Jesus' perfect, pure name we pray. Amen. That was a little long prayer. There's so much been going on and so much we have to thank God for. And I want to say to those who are out there in the land that's listening, if this word, this message touched you in any kind of way, if you feel like it fell on your front porch, because we all have a need of something, and if it had enabled you to better handle yourself, to better look to God, to petition God for some of the things that you need, and if you want to help this ministry here at the St. John Missionary Baptist Church, You can send a donation by GiveLify, or you can send it by PayPal, or you can give a donation the old-fashioned way, which the address is 1282 Bradford Heights Road, Gastonia, North Carolina. And make it out to the St. John's Missionary Baptist Church. And whatever you give for God's ministry, God will definitely give it back to you. No one has ever lost anything by giving to God. The more you learn to give, the more you open up doors for you to give and avenues for you to give. And I want to thank you that you send that to Gastonia, North Carolina. The zip code is 28054. I want to thank you and hope this word does not fall on their ears. So my time is up for today. I want to thank you. I want you to hold on. A change is coming. Hold on. And I want you to look for blessings each and every day. When you get up, I'm praying for you. I'm praying you get a blessing. I want you to look for that blessing, because that blessing is on the way. Hold on. Your change is coming. Don't worry about the pain. God's silence doesn't mean he's not going to react. You hold on. Everything's going to be all right.